to the Big Biz Show. Taking care of business. You want fast-talking, hard-hitting discussions on business and finance? Maybe with a barroom slant and some really salty peanuts? We're not counting calories. We're counting cash. Before we get to the man with the financial plan, meet the money team. Costa, Mary, and Greg. Now, Captain Finance himself, Sully.
Fan to blow on you.
I'll take it over, Greg.
Yep. Captain.
You know what? I was a kid. Horrible story. Were you a Fantastic Four fan?
Absolutely.
Aquaman?
Not really. I mean, he talked to fish. Big whoop.
Yeah. What was the deal with Aquaman? Hey.
Yeah.
Let's get all these salmon in one place.
Let me get that whale over here.
So you had Superman, Wonder Woman.
Right.
And who? And the Hulk?
Hulk. Okay, are we talking Super Friends?
I don't know. I'm talking about
the when we were little? Yeah, the cartoons?
Yeah.
Last Saturday.
Meanwhile, at the Hall of Justice.
And remember the invisible plane?
Yeah, that's that Wonder Woman rode around in.
If you could have any power.
Yeah.
Other than to have as many Funyuns as you could have.
Oh, boy.
Would you have the power of flying? The power of invisibility? Or the powdery regular.
at your age.
Well, you know, nothing like the peace and quiet in the morning.
Well, it's 10 o'clock, excuse me.
I'd like invisibility.
I'm flying. Yeah. Oh, really?
Oh, you're flying?
I want to fly.
Oh, yeah. You're flying, huh?
Yeah, yeah. Because you don't have to be 1,000 feet in the air. It could be just five feet.
Like 1 foot. Yeah.
Yeah, pretty, right, exactly.
Get a 7-Eleven, hit that freaking Slim Jim, go to the
exactly.
What would you take? Would you take invisibility?
I'd do the same thing. No, I'd fly.
I'd take invisibility.
But although that invisible thing is pretty attractive.
Yeah, for obvious reasons. Hey, Howie, would you take invisibility or just never having to come on the show again? As your super-
I'm close to both. I don't know. I worry if Mike's going to be flying and he's
Watch
not going
to
be regular.
Who's catching?
He just said, if he's flying and he's not going to be regular.
That's a big pigeon.
It hit me in mid-flight.
I call Mike in the air a seagull. Are you?
I don't know why I come here.
Wow.
Who's got the pet pterodactyl?
Straight from Wall Street. First of all. Did I understand that Fed Chair Jerome Powell is in front of Congress today or coming up this week? Is that happening? Because if you've never read the book, The Creature from Jekyll Island, you realize that the Federal Reserve is nothing but a scam.
Yep.
They're gonna give the banks money at zero, or in this case, 7% or 6%. When's the last time you had like a 7% credit card or 7% auto loan?
But,
so here's the deal. We're going to get free money. And by the way, nobody knows who owns the Fed. It's not a federal organization. Mm-mm. It's often thought to be owned by the banks that use it. So, no, we're going to print our own money. We're going to borrow our own money. I mean, it really is. There's a better system here. Don't ask me, but there's a better one. So when Jerome Powell, who's an academic, by the way, goes in front of the Congress, what is the purpose here? Is it tap dancing? What's happening?
Yeah, I mean, I call it reading tea leaves. A lot of people do. Why do we have this system? I mean, Churchill has a great quote. He said, democracy is the worst form of government, except for all the others. So I wonder, is this just the best we can do?
I thought Churchill said the coldest winter I spent was a summer in San Francisco. Wrong guy? Sorry, that was Mark Twain. You're right, though. And the point is that the U.S. is the least dirty shirt in the hamper. When it comes to this, it's just
that's a big part of this. Yeah.
And look, everyone does quantitative easing. Everyone prints their own securities to buy them and make money on them. Every country does. There's what they call a stimulus, but stimulus follows inflation follows stimulus. The problem is, Howie, I blame you. I'll talk to you tomorrow.
Yep. The problem is, Howie,
you.
Yes.
And that damn hair.
Oh, so good.
Perfect hair of
it's
yours.
Perfect.
You punctrepreneur. You look a little puffy.
Punctrepreneur. I like that.
We have a salad. Big Biz Show. See you in a minute. this fight going on between the Fed. Again, I got to bring up a great short read that talks about what a scam the Fed is. And I'm no conspiracy theorist here as I play the Twin Peaks theme. Pulled that one out, didn't I?
That is pretty,
that's pretty
smooth.
Good. There you go, man. Creature from Jekyll Island would be the name of the book that you should read.
So you want to know the tale of the creature from Jekyll Island, do ya?
Perfect, I got this one, Sully. The book, published in 1994 by J. Edward Griffin, uncovers the secret history of the United States Federal Reserve System. Our journey starts in 1910, when a group of powerful bankers meet in secret on Jekyll Island just off the coast of Georgia to draft a plan for a central banking system in the United States. The group included men like J.P. Morgan, Paul Warburg, Senator Nelson Aldrich, which, a fun fact, was John D. Rockefeller's father-in-law, talk about nepotism, spent a week in secrecy discussing their plan, which would eventually become the Federal Reserve. They went disguised as duck hunters in secrecy so that they wouldn't face scrutiny from the press or the public. But really, who'd have a problem with a bunch of bankers coming up with the rules for central banking?
Look, Remy, let's just forget about last night, okay? There's just too much possibility for conflict of interest.
Oh. The name of their game is bailout. The Federal Reserve was created to address a bunch of financial panics that occurred during the 19th and 20th century. You see, the Fed was designed to be a lender of last resort, so to speak. However, the Fed's ability to bail out banks leads us to a moral hazard, where banks take on unnecessarily big risks knowing that they're gonna have a bailout if anything goes wrong. Now, the Fed was originally created as protectors of the public, protecting it from financial instability and inflation, including the Great Depression, the inflation of the 1970s, and who could forget that good old 2008 financial crisis and the Great Recession. Doing great, guys. In the early years, the Fed focused on stabilizing the banking system and preventing any more bank failures. But then later, the Fed shifted its focus to controlling the economy through monetary policies, such as controlling factors like the money supply and interest rates. Sound familiar? Now, the money supply, how do you just make money? That's where they came up with the Mandrake mechanism, which pretty much means banks are only required to hold a fraction of their deposits in reserve. The rest of the deposits can be loaned out, creating new money in the process.
So let's talk about the creature that exists today.
The Fed's policies have a significant impact on inflation, employment, and economic growth. However, the Fed's independence and lack of accountability to Americans give off huge vibes of concern about its power and influence. The creature from Jekyll Island essentially argues that the Federal Reserve has been nothing but a disaster for the U.S. economy, leading to inflation, financial instability, and government debt. It suggests that a return to the gold standard and a free market approach would probably be a better alternative to the current system. Ultimately, it's a call to action for Americans to take control of their monetary system and demand more transparency and accountability from their government. All right, back to Sully and the Beef Stew Guy.
Big Biz Show rolling on. Another beautiful day here in sunny Southern California from the Loft 100 studios. I'm Costa, that woman there in the blue, Mary Bird Godwin, our executive producer, Greg Todorov, right here. Sully's wandering around somewhere. May have hit his head. Till he wanders back, I will stand here and try to keep the ship going towards Jekyll Island. Speaking of, our market analyst, Howie Font, he of the most awesome hair, besides Greg on the Big Biz Show. He joins us once again. Howie, when we look at that package done by our Sergeant at Arms Devin Doan, what is the likelihood that we will ever get away from the Federal Reserve?
Zero.
Okay, great. Okay.
So most currencies follow the country that they're of and go to zero in the end. So Danish Empire, even the pound is relatively still strong, but compared to what it was 100 years ago, mm-hmm. value asymptotically goes down, which means it goes as close to zero as possible, but never quite gets to zero. So if you just take a dollar from 50 years ago as one data point, a dollar now and a dollar 100 years ago, you know, $1 100 years ago had much, much more value. Now, the reason this is okay is because the things that the dollars can buy actually does advance. So that's what it takes more dollars to buy an iPhone, but there was no amount of $1990 dollars that could buy an iPhone, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. I mean,
no, it does.
We're always loaning against ourselves, or against our own future. Yeah.
Hey, what's going on right now with hedge funds
and as far as owning single-family houses in the United States?
I'm so glad you brought this up. This is a really popular topic right now because the Senate just took on a House bill. The House has been exploring this since the beginning of the year, but they're actually thinking about banning this practice. So a ton of single family homes on the more expensive side, about 430,000, have been bought up by just the top 10 largest institutional investors. So that's going to be hedge funds and then people like BlackRock, Blackstone, Tiger Global. These guys, they find what they think are good deals, good trades. They don't need the money immediately. They can pay all cash offers. They can pay a little bit higher to the market. And sellers will take that deal every time. But it's driving up the cost of housing and driving out any potential first-time borrowers. So the government is saying, look, there's a version of the bill that says if you have managed more than $1 billion, you're not allowed to buy homes as part of your portfolio.
Okay.
There's another one saying, we're just going to give you a big fat tax, you know, 50% tax on any home that you buy, and that should stop the practice. So there's a couple different things, but I wanted to see what the Nunya crowd thought about this.
Howie Font is our Big Biz Show market analyst. Well, now are these, this 10% you're talking about buying up all this inventory, is it to just buy it, flip it, obviously make a process or some profit? Are some talking in terms of, you know, we'll turn them into 1 week rentals, that type of thing? Or is it merely just flipping the market and no, making a profit, driving the price up?
They are going to do long-term rentals and or flip it because they'll be a very liquid market. I mean,
yeah.
Traditionally you've been able to sell really nice upscale properties fairly easily. For them, it doesn't matter if it takes a month or two to find the right buyer. It's about getting the right price. And in the meantime, yeah, we're going to clip rent. But the philosophy is we'll be the owner and you'll own nothing and like it. You'll pay rent. You don't have to deal with the cost of ownership, but you don't get any of the upside, which is how most people long-term make big money.
We're talking, if we're talking in terms of a housing shortage, what numbers are we looking at right now?
Big. So it depends on how you measure it, but housing units per person, it's between 1.5 and 5.5 million. So lots of housing is needed. It depends on whether you're counting, you know, census or
sure.
What cities say, because immigration and people move from state to state, so the numbers get a little funky, but it is at least several million units that the country needs. And inflation and lumber, I know you've talked about that on the show, has stopped building new homes, but there's also not really much incentive for low margin, smaller, less expensive homes. That you want to build something grand and provide to the top of the market. And so if you have that pressure on one end and the top-heavy pressure of someone buying up all of the homes for their investment portfolio, it doesn't spell a pretty picture.
Howie Font, our Big Biz Show market analyst. You know, Howie, Greg and Mary and myself, a lot of other people in the studio were fortunate enough to own the homes that we live in. And we're hearing more and more, though, about maybe your generation, younger people, that owning maybe, and I can only use California as the test, but do you feel that yourself? You're a younger guy, you're in New York City right now, that, you know, a home is gonna take you longer to procure? Or can you, you know, talking amongst your friends and whatnot, that this is actually a real fear of theirs, never owning the dwelling that they're gonna live in?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. It is the question. I will rebut myself before I give my answer and just say, you know, the big caveat is homes now compared to homes in the 70s, like every other good and services, are way superior. So yes, they should be, and they're actually a bit larger per unit dwelling. So it makes sense that it's up some, but yeah, it shuts people out of, you know, a strong financial future. It shuts people out of stability. And for me, I'm doing fine. I get to appear a couple times a week on the Big Biz Show.
Look at you.
You've made it.
And renting is still the option that makes this. Renting is cheaper than owning. And there's a lot of life choices, I'm sure, that are still affecting millennials. But millennials have kids now and are of age. And if they want to settle down, it's much harder than other generations for this aspect. They have a lot of other things that are going great for them.
He's our Big Biz Show market analyst. He is Howie Font. Howie, always appreciate it, brother. Can't wait to have you on again soon. I hope Sully will be back behind the desk. We still don't know where he is. Good to talk to you, my man. All right, that's Howie Font, Big Biz market analyst. More of the Big Biz Show right after this. Sunny Southern California, the Lock 100 Studios. It is the large financial program, also known as the Big Biz Show. Glad you guys are along for the ride. I am Costa. The lady in blue, Mary Bert Godwin. That man right there in black, Greg Todorov. And Captain Finance himself, Sully.
I got so much to say. Paul Hickey is the president and CEO of ReShape Lifesciences. The ticker symbol RSLS, and of course, ReShape is in the business of minimally invasive medical devices that will target obesity. Can I ask you this, Mike?
You can ask me anything you want.
Are the four food groups little chocolate donuts, gravy, Funyuns, and Bicobis?
Yeah, pretty much.
You're tearing up.
Yeah.
When was the last time you had a piece of fruit? And by the way?
July 4th.
Tots or not.
He remembers the day.
Tots are not fruit.
They aren't.
Does your wife get in your grill about, hey, maybe all have a salad, mister?
All the time.
Yeah. Or do you just go to buy bigger sizes? Has anyone ever said to you, nice top, bro?
without sleeves? No. She's always afraid that Greenpeace is going to be called to roll me back in the water when we go to the beach. So.
You know, you're on a roll.
Yeah.
Which explains the butter on your
Wow, we got them all today. Like,
wow.
Hey, Paul Hickey's here. What's interesting here is you have an FDA-approved lap band system, which people don't – I think there is a renaissance about this. I'm going to bring Paul right up. Paul, first of all, what's interesting here is you guys have cornered the market on this, but is the awareness where you want it to be? Because this is something that's really interesting about – I mean, you've cured the plague of the 20th century, which is obesity.
Yeah, it's awareness. No, not where we want it to be, but it's moving in the right direction. And you know, we've talked before about GLP-1s and you know, the big pharma with Ozempic, Wegovy, and how much that's helped bring awareness and more normalcy to treating obesity than normalcy of being obese. So. I think there's a huge percent of our population, you know, literally 99%, who qualify for surgery or some medical intervention to help them lose weight, and they just don't do it because they're not aware of the comorbidities associated with obesity, you know, including cancers and, you know, other things which are certainly treatable and have the attention that they need to have people take care of themselves when those comorbidities, I'm going through actually recovering from COVID as we speak. Oh, wow. But ultimately, yeah, we got a long ways to go, but we're heading the right direction.
Hey, Paul, is the lap band, is the intention to be in forever for as long as a person's lifespan, and does it have to change, or how does that work?
Yeah, it's adjustable, it's reversible. The intent of it is to go in and put essentially a zip tie around the top of the stomach that you can increase or decrease with this physician or the office of the surgeon who does the procedure. Put fluid in to tighten the band around the stomach or take fluid out. We have patients, the product's over 20 years old and people have had it for over a couple of decades. And others have found that they've tolerate it for less time, and they move to the next step of maybe a more invasive procedure, which is, you know, gastric sleeve bypass that essentially alter your anatomy, unlike the lap band.
Paul Hickey, the president CEO of ReShape Lifesciences, their ticker symbol, RSLS. Paul, do you see that as people who have the procedure or have the band put in and they start to lose weight, that the mental game also kind of comes in line with them losing weight, where they kind of grasp, you know, I've got the lap band in, I can go to any buffet on earth now. No, I've got to start eating right as well.
Well, to clarify your comment about having fruit on the 4th of July, I don't think Jell-O's are fruits.
Really?
I'd like to.
Duly noted.
We think margaritas are fruits, so let's.
could be. Enough limes, enough margaritas might count as one fruit. But all said, there is an adjustment. The disease is not just essentially your gut or your brain, it's both. There's different types of obesity. So by restricting your intake, your body's going to adjust and figure out that your brain has to adjust its hormone levels. Everything has to come back into a line. And that's something that takes time to do. And it's easy to fall back into the weight gain again if you reverse your therapy and choose to essentially release the lap band from the top of your stomach, as I described earlier.
Hey, Paul, let's talk about what Mary is sort of has been critical of, the semaglutide, right? There is a huge downside to taking drugs that reduce muscle mass let's face it, you've got a $50 billion industry worldwide.
Jeez.
I mean, Mike's idea of a lap band is a belt. Crispin's just a little higher. but my point is, semaglutides are working. Wegovy's working, Saxenda is working. There's long-term effects by this. And it's not teaching anybody to monitor their appetite. It's not teaching anybody better lifestyle choices. But it's taking a pill, so to speak, in this case a shot, and it's making them shrink. That's tough to compete with. Talk about your message.
Yeah, it is tough to compete with, but I go back to what I said earlier, like there's 99% of the people on the sideline that should be losing weight and should be figuring out how to do that for the length of their lifetime. I think the drawbacks of the positive side of the GLP-1s is they're here to stay. They're helping millions of people, and that's awesome. I think that's good for my industry and other industries. Not so good for hip replacement or cardiovascular issues, other things that will be essentially minimized with the loss of weight by millions of individuals worldwide. But there's accessibility issues, tolerance issues, certain women in childbearing years that can't take these drugs, and you ideally would like to preserve your anatomy as you're younger in your life. And childhood obesity, young adults, women in childbearing years, elderly who can't, again, tolerate a lot of things, including medications, all sort of fit within sort of our target zone of the ideal patient.
Hey, Greg, you're a fatty, and I know you have trouble trying your shoes. So let me ask you this. Would you consider, if you were a taco shy of a combination plate, would you consider something like this?
100%.
But I like this.
Ever since the Clash going out of business.
That's right. So I think this is an excellent option because you do it one time. And I love that it's adjustable based on how you're doing in your life and how your health is going and what your weight is like. And it's reversible, it's adjustable. And the shots are just, I don't know. I'm not a fan of that idea.
Mike's thinking myself. Hey, can I come in every Saturday to adjust for Sunday brunch and then come back on Monday? His name is Paul Hickey. The name of the company is ReShape Life. Says, Paul, we'd love to have you in the studio sometime, pal, because this is a $30 to $50 billion business worldwide. It's not going anywhere. These guys have the market on this thing. RSLS, their stock symbol. Go to ReShapeLifeSci.com.
When reading the side effects for something is longer in the commercial than the product,
The description,
I'm out.
Yep.
Remember Holestra?
Oh, my God.
Oh, God. In the Doritos?
I had to throw a couch away.
You get that rumble?
Hey.
It's like in the Doritos and the chips.
There was no lead time. It was just I gotta go.
I had no idea we had dip.
Loft 100 Studios, The Big Biz Show, our affiliates, and our hosts are not registered investment advisors or broker-dealers.
Our show hosts make no commitment that the purchase of securities of companies profiled or otherwise mentioned in our programming
are suitable or advisable for any persons, or that investment in such securities would be profitable in general.
Given the nature of our company's profile and the lack of an active trading market for their securities, and investing is highly speculative and carries a high degree of risk.
We profile selected publicly traded and privately held companies on our program.
Most of these companies that we profile have provided compensation to Loft 100 Studios and its host for the profile coverage.
3, 2, 1. From time to time, we sell shares of the company profiled in the open market that we receive as compensation for coverage of client companies.
But never sell stock if we are speaking about, interviewing, or covering a public company who has paid compensation.
Specific questions on compensation can be obtained by contacting producer at sullyandgroup.com.
Listeners should verify all claims and do their own due diligence before investing in any securities mentioned on this program.
Investing in securities is speculative and carries a high degree of risk.
We encourage our investors to invest carefully. Duh.
And read the investor information available on the website.
On the Securities and Exchange Commission, SEC, at www.sec.gov.
Or the Financial Industry Regulatory Authority, FINRA, at www.finra.org.
Listen, baby. 125 million, TV Home Strong, BizTV, Bloomberg, American Forces Network, 175 countries and all the ships at sea. 15 Emmys, 17 Tonys, and a restraining order.
Big Biz Show is on the air.
Like Mike Costa likes to say, convicted? Never. Good to have you along. Thank you to the Day Trader Trio. They're on their best behavior because, you know, it wasn't that great of a weekend.
Oh, no.
Over at the all-you-can-eat fries at Mary Mesa Bowl.
Ooh.
Yeah, they were scraping the popcorn ceiling that day, so it was a little bit. Yep. So we were under construction. It's great when we have one of the viewers in one of the many cities that were in the United States send us an email to Greg Todoroff, our executive producer, saying, you should talk about this company. And by the way, we talked to celebrities and authors and convicted villains. And as well as CEOs of public companies. And this company came our way, and we started looking at it. It's one of the coolest things ever. Now, we've raised, how much have we raised for Challenge Athletes Foundation? Like $300,000 in the last 12 years.
Yep.
For Challenge Athletes Foundation, of course, raising money for those folks that have physical challenges so they can participate in sports. Suddenly, we see this company by the name of LifeWard, stock symbol LFWD. LifeWard, not a paid content guest. We just came to our attention. Has this thing called an exoskeleton. I'm not talking about Mike's extra 15 here. I'm talking about a device that that folks with physical challenges can climb into, and they can ambulate, they can walk, they can do so on and so forth. It was such a great time having you last time. Larry Jasinski is the CEO. He joins us now. Larry, how are you, sir? Good to see you.
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me back.
So listen, can you take us to the top? Because we had so many emails from our viewers across the country, across the world about you. I want to talk about what you call functional ambulatory program, because this is completely different than what we've seen before, and insurance comes into play.
Well, the functional ambulatory was the vision and the mission of the guy who created this originally. He is a man who became paralyzed and wanted everyday life back. So they can walk, go into a restaurant. They can go up steps and downstairs when they need to. They don't have limits. They can. We've had about 40 people do marathon events, either half or even full marathons, such as New York, London, LA Marathon. This is functional ambulation in the way the user wants. This is an interface of the machine and a person together walking once again.
Talk about the journey, because what we know about insurance companies is if you lose a leg, if you end up in a wheelchair, insurance will pay for a wheelchair or a walking leg. They will not pay for let's say a running leg or a let's say a wheelchair that will get you cycling. Mm-hmm. It's and the problem is 30% of those children that suffer from that suffer from obesity and such, and insurance companies feel like it's a privilege to be able to participate in sports, so they don't cover it. You guys have changed that completely, where suddenly you've got insurance companies covering the cost of your device, and now doctors can prescribe it, correct?
That is correct. You look at wheelchairs, they've been around for 2,000 years. Exoskeletons have been around a little over a decade. So in the past 10 years, what we've achieved on individual and private insurers, we've challenged them 245 times or more and gotten them paid for. But most importantly, the Veterans Administration in the United States pays for this if you're a veteran. And on April 12th of this year, the Medicare system completed a five-year process of paying for these for those patients. So if you're a Medicare patient, which is 56% of all spinal cord injury patients in the United States, you can get a exoskeleton paid for if you're on label for indications.
Larry Jasinski is the CEO of LifeWard, their ticker symbol LFWD. Larry, I'm assuming with technology being where it is today that these are ultra light but ultra, ultra strong as far as the physical exoskeletons concerned?
These things are made to be extremely durable. They've got a five-year life like a wheelchair or prosthetic. As I indicated, people have done marathons. We had one of our extreme users went up a 61-story building up the stairs.
Wow.
It is durable. It will work for everyday life and in just about every reasonable situation you put it in.
61 stairs. When's the last time you climbed 61 stairs?
I can't climb six stairs. Are you kidding me?
I want to talk about, Larry, I want to talk about your world famous, I think it's called the Alter G anti-gravity treadmill. This is a big deal.
Well, that is, the DNA of this company is to take on creative, innovative products. And the idea of removing weight when you want to walk or when you want to exercise or when you want to rehab from an injury or you want to improve your overall health was the intention of the Alter G device. And that was something created by NASA at the one end to put weight on your bones so you create and maintain your bone density. We're doing the opposite. You can sit on this device, stand on this device, run in this device, and put anywhere from 0 to 100% of your body weight. So you typically set it for what you need for recovery and lessen it. For people that are recovering from a sports injury, people that are recovering from a surgery, people with claudication or peripheral vascular pain, for individuals who, because their weight cannot put all of their weight on their bones comfortably, that allows them to walk and exercise.
Yeah, it's like Mike, he's a taco shy of a combination plate here. And if he wants to get on the treadmill and maybe lose a couple of LBs, he can set that thing to where he can actually walk a little bit.
Yeah.
Right? Versus, because what does Greg say? If you go to the all-you-can-eat thing, there's a lot of walking there, but it's not enough walking, Greg.
Will it hold or sustain a VW?
A small one.
Yeah, okay, great.
Larry, I want to go back to the exoskeleton for a moment because I'm just thinking, so this is for people that maybe get in an accident. They wake up and normally the doctor would say, you will never walk again. You had some spinal cord injury and you're a paraplegic. But this is something that they could use to walk again, right? So those words wouldn't come out of a doctor's mouth anymore because now this is there for them to be able to walk again. Is that correct?
Well, until it was paid for, the answer from the doctors was, get used to it, you'll never walk again. Now that it's paid for, these doctors can write a prescription for these patients, and they will be able to walk when they want to walk, whether it's at home or whether it's at work or whether it's just to go for a walk with their kids.
Hey, Larry, so as a public company, of course, his name is Larry Jasinski, CEO of LifeWard, LFWD is our stock symbol. What's next for you guys for the rest of the year? How much can you share with us as a CEO?
Well, for the rest of this year, our main focus is education. We have to teach physicians, that's now covered. We have to give them the indications, what patients are qualified, which are not. And we have to tell them and help them how the process works. So if they write the prescription, we will help take it through the CMS process and take care of their patients. And then lastly, and most important, building trainer centers all around the United States. So when a person wants to use this device and wants to get trained to live their life walking once again, which is our original dream, that they've got a place to do it. And so our focus this year is execution. So you're gonna see a growth in the number of units. We'll double this year over last year. We'll double it again next year. We'll double it in the year after that. So you're gonna see these on the streets of your cities.
We gotta get you in studio with a patient.
I mean, I wanna see that. We'd love to bring them.
His name is Larry Jasinski. He is the CEO of LifeWard. I love W. I'm going to get one of those anti-gravity treadmills, bro.
Okay.
It's got a cup holder, it's got a phone holder, and a Funyuns holder with some Baco bits on the side, bro.
I was thinking to myself, I wonder if anyone has reached out to him and said, can you make an equine model? You know how when they rehab horses?
Asking for a friend.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I'm just thinking to myself.
Right.
Is that the next, you know, helping pets and stuff?
With was the next question really about horses?
I wasn't going to ask it, but I was just curious. Yeah.
Hey, you know, we've all been wondering is,
crazy.
Can you help a magna doodle walk down the street? You know, they don't shed. Hey, Biz Show. See you in a minute.
You're an idiot. Wherever you are watching, wherever you are listening from, we are in Southern California in the Loft 100 Studios. It is the Big Biz Show. I'm Costa, that's Mary Brett Godwin. Our executive producer is Greg Kotaroff. Sully dipped out again.
That's left us.
They're telling me he's having a problem with his prosthetic hip.
Oh, that is.
The ball joint is locking. I don't know where he went. He said, I got to go do something. Maybe see a man about a horse, I don't know. We appreciate you being with us, though, here on the Big Biz Show. Joining us right now, he's one of my favorite guests because Sully has alluded to this before, how much money Steve JJ Weisman has not only saved him, but saved his daughters. And I think he saved a lot of people a lot of money when it comes to the scams and the pitfalls. He keeps her from stepping in. The website is scamicide.com. And Steve JJ Weisman with us back here on the Big Biz Show. Mr. Weisman, how are you, sir? Always great to have you.
We're getting kind of California weather out here on the East Coast.
Are you?
It's awfully warm, but no fires.
Yeah, it's a little warm out here as well. But we're you know, you guys have the humidity. We have the we've got the dry heat. JJ, what's coming up? I mean, as far as scams are concerned, you don't know what scams are coming up, but I know that Amazon Prime Day is coming up, and I would assume that this is probably a prime target, pardon the pun, for the scammers out there.
Yeah, you assume correctly. You know, anything that is popular with the public is going to be popular with the scammers. And so Amazon Prime, a lot of people are interested in that. And so what the scammers are doing is they're posing as Amazon. So you may get a text message or an email or a pop-up ad. Now, it can be anything from there's a problem with your order and you need to click on this link to go to a website, the Amazon website, where will ask for personal information and maybe a credit card to straighten it out, or it may be an advertisement supposedly from Amazon for some product at a great price. And there are kind of a couple of problems here. Of course, if you click on that link, you may be downloading malware. It can be keystroke logging malware that will steal the information from your computer, make you a victim of identity theft, or get access to your accounts. Or they may just lure you into providing the information or pay the credit card on there. So this is, you know, one of my mottos is things aren't as bad as you think, they're far worse. And it has really gotten worse in the last few years because of artificial intelligence.
And that too.
Yeah. That's been a problem too, but we won't go there. So the problem is that at one time, well, for instance, a few years ago, Interpol said there are only about 100 cyber criminal geniuses in the world. But what's happened is now any cyber criminal idiot can go on artificial intelligence and create a website that looks just like Amazon. They can create phishing emails and text messages that look just like Amazon. And so people are going to be having their guard down. They're expecting to hear or communicate with Amazon. And instead, they're going to be communicating with scammers. So I think the key thing is BS, be skeptical. you can never be sure when you get an email, a text message, or a phone call who is actually contacting you. So anytime you're asked to click on a link, download an attachment, provide personal information, or make a payment, you got to confirm that it actually is a legitimate communication. So unfortunately, that's the world we're in today. And there are going to be a lot of people scammed out of a lot of money on Amazon Prime Day because they just don't think before they click or provide that information.
Hey, Steven, speaking of that, is there a rule of thumb that I can maybe tell my elderly mom and her husband, you know, a simple rule of thumb to say how to provide, you know, how to get that proof? Because, you know, like you said, it could look exactly like the same Amazon website. And I know my mom fell for, you know, she said, oh, the San Diego Police Department called and wants some money, and I'm trying to figure out. Jim got mad at me because I couldn't get my bank information. I said, Mom, that's not the police. Yeah. But, you know, how do they know what not to click and what to click? I think maybe younger generations are more savvy, but I know some of the older generations are not.
Well, first of all, let's kick those younger generations in the butt right now.
Yes.
They should be more savvy. They know how to use tech better. And the most scammed people are the elderly and the young people, the college students and that generation, because they just trust the technology too much. But with seniors, one of the things is a good rule of thumb is anytime anyone is asking for a payment with a gift card, it's a scam. And it's a real sad commentary that the IRS actually has to have on its website. We do not accept gift cards. If you're asked for a gift card, yes. And, you know, it's, I don't know, maybe it's Darwin and the thinning of the herd. What generally I tell people is, how do you confirm? If it is from Amazon, you have to type in the real Amazon URL and make sure you're doing it correctly, because interestingly enough, some of the scammers will get domains and sites that are maybe one letter off that people sometimes may type in wrong. So you've got to go, if it's a company saying that you owe them, and you go to your bill and actually look there for what the phone number is. Don't trust the phone numbers or link. And here again, it's even worse. You go, if you're going to your Google or search engine, and very often, if you type in the name, what'll come up is the scammer site. Because what happens is the scammers sometimes will take the easy way out, and they'll pay for advertising to put their site up at the top. Other times, the more sophisticated scammers are able to manipulate the algorithm so it'll come to the top. So you have to be very, very careful that you're actually going to the real websites and the real phone numbers. Your bills are the best place to look for those.
Steve Weisman, the CEO, scamicide.com is the website to go to, scamicide.com. Steve, you've got about a minute left. Quickly, what happened with this password breach? 10 billion passwords?
Yeah, it's only 10 billion passwords. You know, there are two lessons here. One is, this is not a new data breach. It is an accumulation of data breaches that have been around for years. And the key problem is what they call credential stuffing, people using the same password over and over for other accounts. So you should always have a unique password for each of your accounts. You can also go to a site, Have I Been Pawned? And just take the A out. Have I Been Pawned? And that will show you what data breaches have been involved with your information. But have a unique password for each of your accounts, and that's the way to protect
yourself. Save yourself some money. Scamicide.com, S-C-A-M-I-C-I-D-E.com. He is the CEO. Steven JJ Weisman. Mr. Weisman, always appreciate the visit. Hopefully some people are going to heed your suggestions, save themselves some money. That's going to do it for the Big Biz Show. Sully is, I don't know, but I think we handled it pretty well.
Nailed it.
He's busy.
We didn't freak out. All right, thanks for being along for the ride. We'll see you next time.
Nice work, Mikey.